Hello students, welcome to the class 4 of module 4. So in today's class we are going to discuss of the last chapter of this particular module, that is chapter number 9, visible surface detection methods. Okay, so here it talks about the surface and it talks about the viewing. Okay, means we are going to see the interaction between the viewer and the material surface. Okay, so based upon that we are going to detect, okay, what part of the surface of that given object is visible to the viewer. Okay, that should be highlighted, and with whatever is not visible to the viewer, that will be eliminated. Generation of realistic graphic displays is determining what is visible within a scene from a chosen viewing position. Means the based upon the camera or the viewer's viewing position, we can get a realistic graphic display, okay, so that we can form a desired scene. The various algorithms are referred to as visible surface detection methods. Sometimes this method we also call it as a hidden surface elimination method. Okay, so in this particular method, okay, as the name itself suggests, it is going to detect those surfaces which are visible to the viewer. Okay, or in other words, it is going to eliminate those surfaces, okay, which are not at all hidden from the viewer. Both are same only, there is no any difference. Okay, they both are aliasing with each other. Classification of visible surface detection algorithms. So we can broadly classify visible surface detection algorithm according to whether they deal with the object definition or with their projected images. So here, based up here in this visible surface detection, we have two types. One is object space, other one is image space methods. So in the object space, normally we are going to focus on the object definition. Object definitions are nothing but the geometrical property, okay, and the geometrical entities of the given object. And in the image space method, normally we are going to focus on the projection lines, and every projection lines when they hit on the view plane, okay, in form of pixels, okay, in form of pixels, we are going to consider them. Okay, so it is completely geometrical entity, and this one is completely raster entity. So in the object space method, that compares the objects and parts of the object to each other within the scene definition to determine which surface has hole, which we should label as visible. Means if in the object space method we are going to compare the objects, okay, if multiple objects are there within the scene, okay, there is a chances that this multiple objects, they can overlap on each other. So from the viewer's position, what object is completely visible to the viewer, that particular surface will be labeled as it is completely visible. And those objects which are hidden from that front object, okay, that we call it as an invisible surfaces. Okay, and there are some objects they are partially visible. So such kind of objects we are going to label as partially visible. In the image space algorithms, visibility is decided point to point at each pixel position on projection plane. So based upon the pixel position on the scene, okay, we are going to identify, okay, whether that object is near to the viewer or whether it is far from the viewer. For example, assume that there are two polygons are there. So both the polygons are overlapped on each other. Okay, so assume that the color of these two polygons is, one is red and the one is blue. Okay, so here assume that the red polygon is in front of the viewer, and behind to that there is a one more polygon that is a blue color, okay, which is hidden by the red color polygon. So here, first of all, in this image space, it is going to calculate that blue color, that blue surface polygon. Okay, so it is going to remember that blue color, okay, with respect to its pixel values. Okay, means it is in the frame buffer, it is going to hold that blue color. But after some time, it is going to go for the calculation for the red color, okay, red color polygon. So it will come to know that now the pixel value of that particular polygon, red polygon, okay, it is smaller, okay, is smaller than compared to the blue. Okay, why? Means it is based upon the distance between the viewer. So if you take the blue polygon, its pixel value, its pixel, okay, that is somewhat far from the viewer, okay, but the red color, its Z value, normally we will store it in a Z, okay, so it is very near to the viewer. So the pixel value, whichever is very near to the viewer, okay, that will be considered, okay, and that polygon will be completely highlighted. Means here the red polygon will be completely highlighted and blue is completely hidden, okay. So based upon that point to point pixel position, we are going to perform this visible surface operation. That is nothing but we call it as a image space method. There are major differences in the basic approaches taken by the various visible surface detection algorithm. Most of them, obviously, they will use sorting, okay, because they will sort between the polygon positions, okay, what value of the polygon is very near to the viewer, which polygon values are far from the viewer. Based upon that, we will come to know that which one should be visible completely, which one should be shown completely, and which one should be neglected completely. Okay, so here most of the time we are going to sort on the, especially on the Z values and coherence method to improve the performance. Coherence means all these pixels, okay, these values are coherent with each other, okay, they should be tightly coupled, okay, then only we can get the desired images, okay. If the pixels values are stored far from each other, then we are going to get a kind of a different kind of image, okay, and it is not give a better result, okay. So here sorting is used to facilitate depth comparisons by ordering the individual surfaces in the scene according to their distance from the view plane. Okay, so here this sorting is also performed the depth comparison. Depth comparison, what is a depth? Depth is nothing but it is the distance, okay, between the object and the viewer. Okay, as the distance decreases, okay, that object is very, very near to the viewer so that he can completely see the all the faces of that particular object. Okay, if the depth value increases, okay, then that object is far from the viewer, so he may not get all the, he may not perceive all the faces of that image or of that object. Coherence methods are used to take the advantage of regularities in the scene. Okay, means every pixel should be placed near by each other so that we can form a proper image. Then in that we have a back face detection. Okay, so we know that whenever we consider any polygon, it consists of two faces. That is, one is a front face and the one is by default back face. The front face is that face which is visible to the viewer, and that we call it as a front face, and that face which is hidden by the which is hidden to the viewer, okay, that we call it as a back face. So here, a fast and simple object space method. See here, we are considering the object space method, okay, which is completely relied on the object descriptions. For locating the back faces of the polyhedron is based on the front-back test, okay. So here, we are going to perform the front and back test, okay. So we want to come to know that a given polygon, which one is the front face and which one is the back face. Consider a point XYZ is behind a polygon surface if AX plus BY plus CZ plus D is less than 0. See here, this AX plus BY plus CZ plus D is equals to 0 is nothing but it is our plane equation, okay, which indicates that whenever this AX plus BY plus CZ plus D is equals to 0 means all this X, Y, and Z value of that particular point P is exactly lies on the plane. Okay. So if here, if the AX plus BY plus CZ plus D is less than 0 means our point is lies below to the polygon surface. Okay. So it is lies below to the polygon surface. If AX plus BY plus CZ plus D is greater than 0, which indicates that our point, that is a point P of XYZ, is lies above the polygon surface, or simply we call it as a plane. Okay, it lies above the plane. So here we are testing on the back face. So obviously we are going to consider the plane equation, and in that ax plus by plus cz plus d is less than zero, where a, b, c and d are the plane parameters for the polygon. When this position is along the line of sight to the surface, we must be looking at the back of the polygon. Therefore, we could use the viewing position to test for back faces. See, as we know that this equation represents that our point, that is XYZ, lies below to the plane. Okay, based upon that, we will come to know that that position is behind the surface. Okay, behind the surface. So obviously we will come to know that we are identifying, we have detected the back face. Okay, that is the back face. Therefore, we could use the viewing position to test for back faces. Now you can use the viewing position. Now you can set the camera parameters. You can use the viewing orientations. So to come to know that whether that is a back face or not. We can simplify the back face test by considering the direction of the normal vector L for polygon surface. If V view, okay, that is a view up vector, is a vector in the viewing direction from our camera position, then the polygon is back face if this view up vector dot product with the normal vector, if it is greater than zero. So here, whenever we are taking the normal vector, see, if this is the polygon, okay, and this is the back face, okay, so see here is the camera, okay, so this face is hidden, okay, hidden to this viewer. So from that point, we are going to take the normal. Okay, so normal is nothing but normal is a kind of vector which is having angle, which is having some angle 90 degree, okay, to this particular plane. See, this is a kind of plane, right? Okay, so here it lies on ABC, okay, ABC, okay, and here we are going to take the normal vector, okay, which is having some angle 90 degree, okay, and it is pointing to it is coming out of that polygon. And here this viewer is looking at this particular object. So here it is taken as view up vector. So whenever you are performing the dot product between this view up vector and this normal vector, if your value is greater than zero, which indicates that whatever that phase, okay, from where you have taken the normal, it is hidden to the viewer. Okay, it is not going to be displayed. In contradict to it, if V view dot n is greater than, if it is less than zero, which indicates that this particular surface is near to the viewer. Okay, so see here, whenever you are getting the greater value, okay, which indicates that object is far from the viewer may not see the faces of that polygon. Okay, if this dot product value goes less, okay, so that indicates that we are that object is very near to the viewer, so that it can completely pursue that faces of that object. Okay, polygon is a back face if the z component c of its normal vector n satisfies, that is a c is less than zero. Okay, so you can see here this z value. Okay, z value plays very important role. So because normally the z value will indicate, okay, whether the object and the viewer, okay, whether both are near to each other or whether they are far from each other. Okay, because if you plot, okay, with respect to this viewer, this is the x-axis, this is the y-axis, and this will be the z-axis. So this z-axis will determine, okay, whether the objects are near to each other, object and viewer are near to each other, or whether they are far from each other. Okay. So this z component is associated with the c for its normal vector n. Okay, if the c value is less than zero, normally we will come to that face. Okay, this face will be, it will be far from the viewer. Okay, but I suggest you to go through with this equation. It will simplify. Okay. Next one, a very important method, that is a depth buffer method. Okay, so here a commonly used image space approach. See, it is this method, okay, comes under image space approach. for detecting means it is completely based on the pixel form. Okay, for detecting the visible surfaces is the depth buffer method. I hope multiple times in the lab program you have studied, you have seen a depth buffer. Okay, so here we are going to see what is that depth buffer, which compares surface depth values throughout the scene for each pixel position on the projection plane. Okay, so here it is going to compare the surface depth values. Okay, surface depth values throughout the scene for each pixel positions on the projection plane. Okay, so you just remember this one. I will come to that point. Here, each surfaces of a scene is processed separately, one pixel position at a time across the surface. The algorithm is usually applied to scenes containing only polygon surfaces because depth values can be computed very quickly and the method is easy to implement. This visibility detection approach is also called Z buffer method, since object depth is usually measured along the Z axis of viewing system. Okay, see, the another name for this depth buffer method is nothing but Z buffer method. Okay, so here normally it is going to focus on the Z value. Okay, so let us see this figure here. Assume that this is the viewer location. Okay, this is the viewer location, and in front of that viewer a view plane will be there. Okay, and here some set of multiple objects are there. Okay, S1, S2 and S3. Okay, so here assume that this S1, S2 and S3, they are overlapped on each other. They are overlapped on each other. Now, first we are going to process on this S3. Okay, or it is not necessary that you can start with S3, you can start with the S1 also. Okay, let me see. Well, for my understanding, I'm taking from S3. Okay, so with respect to this S3, I will take any one point. Okay, one random point I will choose. So that projection, okay, the projection of this S3 object is falling on the view plane, right? So in this, whenever I take this particular position, okay, I got the X value, Y value, right? That is the X value and Y value. Okay, similarly, I will get the Z value, right? So this Z value will be stored. Okay, that will be stored in Z buffer. Okay, next I will process for S2. Okay, so in the S2, now I'm going to calculate again. I will take some point from that S2 object. So here X will be there, next Y will be there, and Z will be there. But now, because of this overlapping between the S2 and S3, I'm going to compute which Z value is near to the viewer. So I'm going to compare the Z value of S3 and Z value of S2. Wherever I'm getting the short means a smaller Z value, that will be remembered. Okay. And the higher value of Z, that will be discarded. Okay. Okay. Similarly, I'm going to perform for S1. Okay. Now S1, that will be compared with the S2. Okay. Yes, the same X and Y values that can be remembered. Okay. But when it comes about Z axis, so again, I'm going to compare the Z value between the S1 and S2. Here, S1 Z value, okay, is very smaller as compared to the S2 because the Z value is very near to the viewer. Okay, hence Z value is shorter, okay, as compared to the S2. So the smaller one means this will be projected on this view plane. Means here on this view plane, that whatever that point I'm going to get with respect to X and Y value, with this having the X and Y, along with the Z value of S1 will be remembered, and all this S3 and S2 will be discarded. Means they are overlapped. Okay, they are overlapped. That will not be highlighted on my view plane. Okay, so just remember that the depth buffer is also called as Z buffer. At each surface is processed, its depth from the view plane is compared to previously processed surfaces. If surfaces closer than any previously processed surfaces, its surface color is calculated and saved along with its depth. Okay, so as I said in this with respect to this figure, okay, its explanation has been given here. Okay, so that you can go through these statements. Implementation of the depth buffer algorithm is typically carried out in normalized coordinates. See, in the normalized coordinate frames, okay, normally we are going to use this depth buffer algorithms so that depth values ranges from 0 at near and 1 for far tripping plane. Okay, see, normally the depth value, the smallest depth value is 0 and the highest depth value will be 1. Okay, so normally this depth value ranges from 0 for near clipping planes, okay, and 1 for the far clipping planes. A depth buffer is used to store the depth values for each xy position. What is a depth? Depth is nothing but it is a distance between the user, the viewer and the object. Normally we will use the z values, okay, that is the depth value. Okay, so for each xy position as the surfaces are processed and the frame buffer stores the surface color values for each pixel positions. Okay, so whenever you calculate all these z values, okay, for any object, okay, that will be stored it in a frame buffer. Okay, frame buffer is a master buffer, okay, in which we will have all the types of buffer. It may be the color buffer, RGB buffer, depth buffer, auxiliary buffer. Then multiple buffers will come under frame buffer. Initially, all positions in the depth buffer are set to 1. Okay, we will think that the object, okay, that the depth value is 1. Okay, means we will assume that object is far. Okay, so we will now, whenever we are processing any object, normally its depth value we will always assign with the 1. Okay. And the frame buffer is initialized to background color. And whenever we are processing each and every depth values, whenever we come to know that we are getting the shorter value, that shorter values we are going to remember. Okay. And that will be the depth value. Okay. Each surface listed in the polygon tables is then processed. One scan line at a time by calculating the depth value at each XY pixel position. See, here it depends upon the scan line algorithm. Okay, so here you are calculating the depth value based upon the scan line algorithm. So here, as we have studied in the scan line algorithm, a polygon table will be maintained, and within that we are going to trace, okay, that which one is inside, which one is outside, okay, and which one is a near, which one is a far. Okay, based upon the scan lines we will determine. So here the depth value can be determined with the help of scan line operation. This calculated depth is compared to the value previously stored in the depth buffer for that pixel position. Okay, now whatever the newly computed depth value that you got, okay, that you will compute, that you are going to compare with the value, that depth value that you already placed, that is something, but here already set is 1. Okay, you are going to compare. If the calculated depth is less than the value stored in the depth buffer, the new depth value will be stored. Means if you are getting some depth value has a 0.85, okay, so as this 0.85 is less than 1, right, now the what is the new depth value for this depth buffer? That will be 0.85. okay, then the surface color at that position is computed and placed in the corresponding pixel location in the frame buffer. Okay, in the frame buffer or color buffer. Once you come to know that particular depth value, now its depth color, okay, that is its color, that is also be stored in a frame buffer. Let us see, at surface position XY, the depth is calculated from the plane equation. Okay, so this is the plane equation, that is nothing but ax plus by plus cz plus d equals to 0. Okay, so now here we want to calculate the depth. What is the depth? That is nothing but z. So by rearranging that equation, we are going to get this equation. Okay, for any scan line, adjacent horizontal x positions across the line differ by plus or minus 1. Okay, so adjacent x positions, okay, for this scan line, it may be plus 1 or it may be minus 1. See here, if it is x, means it's adjacent, means with that will be x plus 1, or if it adjacent on the left side, it will be x minus 1. Okay, similarly for the y values, okay, for the adjacent scan line, this is the adjacent scan line, that will be plus or minus 1. Okay, so here y, it will be y minus 1. And on the top, it will become y plus 1. Okay, if the depth of position xy has been determined to the z, to be the z, then the depth z dash of the next position, x plus 1, comma y. Okay, so for the depth position, okay, for this xy, okay, for this xy, okay, we came to know that what is the depth value. Okay, so that will be determined as a z. Okay, now whenever I go for the next scan line, okay, now it's a depth value, okay, I'm going to rename as a z dash. Okay, that is for the, let us assume the next position will be x plus 1 comma y. Okay, so along the scan line is obtained from the above equation. So what we can do, okay, take this particular equation, wherever there is a x, substitute with the x plus 1 and y is as it is. Okay, so once you apply these values in this one, now you can rearrange the terms. Okay, so yes, once you simplify this equation, minus ax minus a minus by minus t divided by c. Okay, so here that is nothing but if you simplify further, our equation will become z dash equals to z minus a by c. Okay, so if you simplify again, this z is nothing but you are going to get this equation minus a by c. This ratio minus a by c is constant for each surface. Okay, it will be throughout the surface, it is always constant. Okay, because it is a plane equation. Plane means it is a complete flat. Okay, so whatever the position that you consider from the plane, okay, it will be always constant. Processing the pixel positions from left to right across the each scan line, we start by calculating the depth on left polygon edge that intersect that scan line. Okay, so we will start from whenever we start this scan line operation. Okay, I hope you remember in the first module we have already discussed on this scan line operation. Okay, it always starts from the left to right. Okay, left to right, once that we call it as a, that is we call it as a normal scan. Okay, now we are call it as a normal scan line operation. Okay, once it goes to that particular right side, again it will come back to the left side. Okay, that is what we call it as a interlaced. Okay, that is what we call it as a, sorry, interleaved scan line. Okay, so once we start scanning this scan line, okay, if this is the object, I hope you can see this object. Okay, there is a triangle. Okay, wherever it comes to know, okay, there is a one edge. Okay, so it is going to, that scan line is going to intersect to that particular edge. Okay, so now it is going to determine the depth value of it. Okay, it is going to calculate the depth on the left polygon edge that intersects that scan line. For each successive position across the scan line, we then calculate the depth value z dash. Once you calculate this z value, subsequently now you can calculate the z dash value. Okay, z dash value is nothing but what? Okay, we have used x plus 1 y comma y, right? Okay, for that scan line. Okay, so this is our scan line. So this is, if I take this one as a x comma y, so what will be the next one? That will be x plus 1 comma y. Okay, so in the same sense, okay, once you got the values for this one, it will become x comma y. Okay, for the next pixel, it will become x plus 1 comma y. So in the same sense, we are going to repeat the procedure unless and until we will come to know that this particular boundary of that particular polygon has been ended over here, so that scan line can come to the next line. Okay, so we can implement the depth buffer algorithm by starting at the top vertex of the polygon, then we could recursively calculate the x coordinate values down a left edge polygon. Okay, so similarly we can calculate for complete x coordinate value. Once we have completed, then we can go for the lower one. Okay, see, once we have calculated the complete x value, that is x comma y. Okay, after that x plus 1 comma y. Okay, so similarly we have calculated, after that our scan line will is going to decrement. Okay, that is a y minus 1. So it will become, see here, it will become x comma, okay, let us assume that it became x comma y minus 1. Okay, x comma y minus 1. What will be the next one? That will be x plus 1 comma y minus 1. Okay, in the same sense we are going to proceed, okay, for every scan line. okay, same terms, but okay, but we are going to repeat again and again. Okay, the x value for the beginning position on each scan line can be calculated from the beginning edge. Okay, that is for the x value for of the previous scan line. That is already the x value, okay, that we have determined. Okay, for the x dash value, we are just going to use the slope, that is x minus 1 by m. Okay, where m is the slope of the edge, then the depth values down to this next y minus 1 scan line will be, that is z dash equals to z plus a by m plus b by c. Okay, so you just need to analyze. Okay, just have to take the paper and pen and you have to analyze. Okay, by using this positions, okay, then you can easily understand how we got that equations. Okay, so with respect to the OpenGL commands for this visibility detection functions, we are going to use the cull phase. Okay, so in the cull phase, it is going to say that which phase, okay, that you want to remove. Okay, so if you want to remove the back phase, then you can go for GL cull phase and you can specify GL underscore back. Okay, so before doing that one, you have to enable that. Okay, you are saying that to the OpenGL that I'm enabling the culling the faces. Okay, and these are the commands that we have already studied in the lab. Okay, just to go through that. Okay, so before using the depth buffer, okay, you have to initialize in the display mode, that is a glut underscore depth here, and you have to clear the depth buffer like you are clearing the color RGB color. Similarly, you have to enable the depth test. Okay, then once you're done, okay, you can go for disable, but by default always it is always disabled. Okay, but you explicitly have to enable. Okay, and by default it always takes the depth value between the 0 to 1. Okay, and if you want you can change the depth value also. Okay, so if you want, you can clear the depth, you can clear it. Okay, and if you want to specify your own depth range, you can specify here. Okay, by default it is always 0 for the near depth. Okay, that is for the near clipping plane, and for far clipping plane that is always 1. Okay, and whenever you want to perform some testing, okay, means comparing the depth values between the multiple objects, okay, which is having the greater depth values, whichever is having the smaller depth values, you can go with this particular commands. Okay, and the next one is a wireframed. If you want a wireframed kind of object, then you can specify, okay, what face, okay, that you want to display, okay, with the wireframed structure. Okay, for that you can use the GL underscore line. Okay, so you are going to get a kind of lines. Okay, line kind of, that is something, but I hope in your geography you have seen this latitude, longitude, that kind of lines you can get. Okay, so normally the primitive that we have used is lines here. Okay, if you use the points, GL underscore points, you are not going to get the lines, you are going to get the points. Okay, but the problem here is you are not able to see that points. Okay, for that you have to increase the size of the points. Okay, and for which phase you want to see that wireframe structure, that you can specify here. For both front and back we have specified. If you want only for the front, you can just specify GL underscore front. Okay, the next one is a depth queuing function. Okay, I hope you remember the depth queuing function. Okay, we have just the depth queuing function is the thing, but the object, okay, whichever the part of the object whichever is near to the viewer, okay, its intensity, okay, the part of that object intensity will be increased, so that the object that viewer will come to know that object is near to him. Okay, if that object surface is outside, if it is far from the viewer, then its intensity can be reduced. Okay, so in that sense we are going to use this depth queuing functions. Okay, so here completes our fourth module. Thanks for listening.